You are now ready to see a quantum key distribution protocol, namely the famous BB84 protocol. To execute this protocol, Alice and Bob, of course, need a quantum channel to deliver qubits to each other. In addition, I will, for the moment, assume that they have a classical authenticated channel. In another lecture, you will see how they can make one. Before delving into a full key distribution protocol, we will, as before, start with some useful observations. Let's imagine the following simple setting. Let's say Alice chooses a basis, 0 or 1, where 0 is for the standard and 1 for the Hadamard basis. She also chooses a random bit, XA. And what she's going to do is that she's going to send that bit encoded in the basis, theta, to Bob. That means if theta is 0, then she sends XA in the standard basis, and if theta is 1, she sends XA in the Hadamard basis. So plus if X is 0 and minus if X is 1. Bob also chooses a random basis, standard or Hadamard, and will measure the incoming qubit in that basis. This gives him some classical measurement outcome, which I will call X tilde. Let's make an observation about this protocol. If Alice and Bob have the same basis, then in fact their bits will agree. Let's make another observation. Because, of course, in our actual protocol, there might be an eavesdropper, Eve, trying to intercept the qubit. Eve cannot clone the qubit. And if you watched the videos in week 0, you might remember the example that we've made there to show that cloning is impossible. It's precisely the relevant example here. If Eve could clone the standard basis, then she cannot clone the Hadamard basis. So how do we go from this simple protocol, just one bit exchanged, to an actual BB84 QKD protocol? The idea is the same that we saw before when we talked about key distribution involving these very special channels. Namely, we will now do this procedure many times. Alice will choose a random bit string, x1 up to x capital N, where capital N is 4 plus eta times little n. So eta is close to 0. It's a confidence parameter that we will choose. So you can think that she chooses roughly 4 times little n bits. Alice also chooses random bases, namely one for each element of the string x. And Bob also chooses random bases. As before, Alice will now proceed to send Bob the bit xj encoded in the basis theta j. Then Bob measures the qubit in the basis theta tilde j to obtain the outcome x tilde j. So we do exactly the same as we did before, but now we do this many times. What is the end result of this? At the end, Alice has a string x and a basis string theta, which says which bit was measured in which basis. Bob also has a string x tilde, namely the string corresponding to his measurement outcomes. He also remembers which basis he measured in, so he has a string theta tilde. Now, by our little observation as before, we know that if they measured in the same basis, then the bits agree. Let me call this procedure distributing BB84 states. We are now ready to look at our BB84 protocol. As a first step, I will make an incredibly unrealistic assumption. Namely, I will assume that there's absolutely no noise on the quantum communication channel from Alice to Bob. The first thing we will do is to distribute BB84 states. Remember that this gives Alice a string X, a basis string theta A, and similarly Bob has a string X tilde of measurement outcomes and a string theta tilde of bases. And these strings agree whenever they're measured in the same bases. The second step is that Bob will announce receipt of these states. Namely, Bob will say, I received them all and I measured them all. What we will do now is sort of similar to the protocol where we distributed the key over the very special classical channel. Now, Alice and Bob will actually tell each other which bases they've measured in, and they will discard all the rounds where they used a different basis. So if we start with roughly 4 n bits, after this step, because Bob and Alice choose their bases randomly, we are left with roughly 2 n bits. We are now in a situation where they share a shorter string. Namely, the string corresponding to all the positions where they measured in the same bases. So if there's no noise, by the properties, all of their bits should now agree. So a very close to the situation that we had before for the special classical channel where Bob didn't have any noise. What they do now is they test whether there were any errors. Alice chooses half of the remaining rounds to test. She tells Bob which rounds are tested, and Bob exchanged the bits corresponding to those rounds. They're going to check, given that in these rounds we measured in the same bases, do we agree? Is Bob's measurement outcome exactly equal to the bit X that Alice prepared? From this, Alice and Bob can compute an error rate that we will call delta. Delta is going to be the number of incorrect bits, number of positions of the tested bits where they disagree, divided by the number of tested bits. So the number of tested bits is roughly n times 2, because Alice chooses each bit with equal probability to be tested. Remember that for the moment we made these funny assumptions that there's no noise. So we don't expect any error. The error rate should be 0. I'm then going to say that if they see any error rate at all, they're going to abort the protocol. What's next? Let's go think back to where we distributed keys over our special classical noisy channel. We now have a situation which is very similar. Alice has a string, Bob has a string. For now there's no noise, so they agree. And Eve may have maybe some knowledge about the string. What we're going to do now is the same as before. Namely, Alice is going to choose an extractor seed Y and send it to Bob. Alice computes Ka, namely the extractor function applied to the remaining bit string of roughly n bits. And the seed Y. Similarly, Bob computes KB, the extractor function applied to his remaining string, and the extractor seed Y. This would be our protocol. Remember that to say that something is a key distribution protocol, we now have to check two things. First, we have to check that the protocol is correct. This means that KA should be equal to KB. Why would this be the case here? We know that because there's no noise, the string that Alice has, the remaining string, is in fact exactly the same as Bob's remaining string. So if they apply the extractor function to the same inputs, the same string X and the seed Y, they get the same outputs, KA equals KB. Hence, the protocol is correct. Is the protocol secure? The intuition is that if Eve tries to tamper at all with the qubits, then with very high probability the test that Alice and Bob will perform catches her out. So the probability that Eve tried to tamper and they still don't see any errors is very small. I will not make this precise here yet, so let's first allow for a bit of noise. In a real implementation, it is completely impossible that there's no noise. There will always be some errors, meaning that Bob will always have a noisy version of Alice's bits, even if they're measured in the same bases. Our present protocol cannot deal with that. We would abort if we see a single error. That would be very wasteful. Alice and Bob have exchanged a huge amount of PB84 states. They saw a single error and now they need to abort. Remember also that Eve can always eliminate all errors. So all errors could potentially be due to the eavesdropper Eve. In our current protocol, we would always abort even if Eve tried to tamper just a little bit. This is evidently also not very practical. But it turns out, and we will see that, Alice and Bob can actually still make key even if Eve introduces some, but not too many, errors. To see how this works, let's first look at our protocol. Maybe it actually still works if we just skip the abort step. So the question is, if we don't abort ever, is the protocol still correct? Remember that Alice computed KA and Bob computed KB as follows. But now, because there's an error on the channel, the two remaining strings will very likely not be the same. In fact, the probability that they're the same, if there is even a tiny bit of noise and the string is very long, is very small. So just like in our key distribution protocol on the special channel, we now need to add an extra step, error correction. So let's go and adapt our protocol. Note that the first thing that we have to do is to make sure that the protocol actually completes. I had said that we will abort if we see just a single error. This is clearly unacceptable, so we are going to abort only if the error exceeds a certain threshold. And what we're going to do now, just as in the case of the special classical channel, we're going to add a step with error correcting information. So Alice is going to send some error correcting information C to Bob. What we have to check again now is our protocol correct? Now, of course, the remaining string may not have been the same a priori, but the error correcting information, as before, allows Bob to correct these errors. So we are again back to a situation where XA remain is actually equal to XB remain, the remaining string of Bob, with very high probability. So the protocol is again correct. Why is the protocol secure? We will discuss this at length in the upcoming videos. So here I just want to give you an intuition. If Eve tries to tamper with a channel, then she will introduce errors. And we can use the magnitude of these errors to make an estimate of how much Eve will have tampered. The more errors there are, the more Eve may have learned. In particular, there will be a theorem that says that the min entropy that Eve has about the remaining string is never smaller than n times 1 minus the binary entropy of this error rate here. So we'll see this in detail. Now we know that if we can make a statement about Eve's min entropy by the properties of the randomness extractor in the context of QKD, we will call that privacy amplification, we know that Eve will be ignorant or almost ignorant about the resulting key. We have now seen the BB84 protocol, and we have seen, just by stacking together our building blocks that we've discovered over the past weeks, that the protocol is correct, or epsilon correct. In the upcoming videos, we will discuss in depth the security of the protocol. And let me just summarize that in order to show that we are close to a situation where Eve is ignorant about the key, we need to show that Eve has high min entropy about the string X. A remain. So you're now ready to investigate the security of BB84.